All right. Welcome back, everybody. Sports Chat 503. Thank you guys very much for watching. First time, long time. Either way, I appreciate it. Coming to you live from Portland, Oregon, trying to break it all down here, people, for you during the quarantine. Again, hopefully everybody out there is safe, doing what we're asking everybody to do. Wash your hands, keep your distance, do your thing. We'll get back out there. The economy will bounce back. We'll get back to a new sense of normal or whatever. We might not be shaking hands anymore. Might be doing just kind of a nod or whatever we need to do. But hopefully you guys are staying safe out there. Again, these are very trying times. And it does seem trivial to come out here sometimes and talk about sports when, one, there are no sports going on. Two, there's much, much more pressing issues going on in society. And if you are deeply affected by this, I'm so sorry. The job market, you know, whether it be losing income or rent or anything else that is adversely affecting people out there, my heart goes out to you guys, and if I can help, I would love to try to help. Locally, I'm trying to do whatever I can do, going to the food banks and helping stock a little bit there and doing whatever I can being a public servant during this time. So hopefully everything's well for you guys. This video is something that a lot of people have asked for throughout the time that I've been doing this sports chat. Just to give you a little bit of background, I've done this now for about 10 years, but I've always been invested in Oregon sports since I was a very small child and been very super hyper-focused on all these things throughout my time frame. As a sports fan, as a history guy, I do think they go hand in hand, and you start to think about the greatest of all time or the best teams or any of those kind of things, and then immediately these kind of conversations start to happen. And I thought this was a perfect time. In normal circumstances, I live a fairly busy and active lifestyle. And I would be having practices. I coach basketball team. We would be having games. All that's canceled. No, nothing. So for me right now, I've got a lot of time to be able to kind of invest in different ways. And what I've done is I've gone back into the history books. I've gone back into a tremendous amount of YouTube footage. Footage from the university as well. I've got a couple friends of mine, cohorts, as you would say, out there in the interwebs to hook me up with some other sort of stuff. And I went through a lot of film. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a video where I'm going to go through what I think are the top 10 players at a variety of positions. And I will post them as we go through this process over the next maybe 2 weeks, 3 weeks or so. Of course, everybody likes to start with the quarterbacks, the big questions there. So again, going into this year, I'll definitely have more stuff as we go through coming up for this next season. But this is kind of a look back using this quarantine time to be able to kind of get into different topics that we'd normally not really invest in. I have the top 10 Oregon quarterbacks from my perspective. And I've got some names on the outside of this thing that we'll talk about in a second as well. Again, I like to think about this list under a couple different perspectives. One, who was the best for the time that they were doing it? So compare a guy like Justin Herbert that played 4 years with a guy like Vernon Adams that played 1 year. When Vernon Adams plays, he's an electric player, great quarterback. Justin Herbert played, steady player, put up a lot of numbers. How do they compete? How do you put them in a ranking sort of system? So I do rank a little bit higher some of the players that played longer, maybe some more career stats than some of the guys that just played for a year or two. But for the most part, I kind of try to have it as the modern time. We'll talk a little bit about this as we go, okay? First things first, I'm a history guy, and you got to go back into some history, okay? The best quarterback probably in Oregon at all time is Norm Van Brocklin. Amazing player. After that, George Shaw. George Shaw is the number one pick for Baltimore and gets hurt in the second year, and Unitas takes over. The birth of Johnny Unitas. So George Shaw is almost kind of a Wally Pipp, if you guys know the story of Wally Pipp and Lou Gehrig. So those are kind of the old guys that, you know, might not be able to apply to the newer generation of quarterbacks, just their numbers, everything else. The game has changed a tremendous amount. and whatnot. But so I give kind of two quarterbacks from the old days, and I'll do this with all these lists. I'll have kind of one of the old, and then my favorite that's not really on the list, and then go through these 10. My favorite not on the list is Dennis Dixon. I do not have Dennis Dixon in the top 10 for a wide variety of reasons, but he was one of my absolute favorites of all time. There's a time I think I can argue that he's one of the best quarterbacks of all time. I just don't have really the numbers to prove it long term, and he's had some ups and downs in his career and injuries and everything else, but Dennis Dixon was definitely my favorite. Okay, let's go through these. I got the honorable mention to start with. I said it before, is Vernon Adams. I don't know where to put him. As a quarterback, I think he's very gifted. The ASU game, still to this day, one of the craziest games we've ever seen, with that last second throw in the end zone. Unbelievable player, unbelievable gutsy player, and just a phenomenal, phenomenal, phenomenal player. He had 5 games over 300 yards during that one season, including game against USC where he went 20-25 with 6 touchdowns, 407 yards in 2015. He was there right at the tipping point. You know, that Helfrich team went to the national championship. You bring in Vernon Adams the next year, and you're just kind of surviving a little bit until the wheels fall off the next year. Okay, let's go number 10. I got Darren Thomas at 10. I think Darren Thomas, a very underrated player. He's got the numbers to back it up. He could be the quarterback for the best offense of all time at Oregon. Very good leader, pretty calm under pressure. The thing I always remember about Darren Thomas is he would release the ball so late, guys would be right in on his chest before he'd throw it. It would really give the players, the receivers, a chance to catch the ball and do something with it. I always thought he was a really, really good quarterback for that system at that time. Made a lot of sense. Was not a runner. He could run a little bit, but was very slow out of the pocket running. But really amazing. 24-3 as a starter. So again, numbers-wise, I think he's there. Number 9 is a childhood favorite of mine. It's Chris Miller. Chris Miller, to me, is the closest example to what Justin Herbert is. Big guy, big arm, NFL prospect, looks the part. Chris Miller, 83-86, had 6,841 total yards during that time. That puts him in the top 10. Career guy, started as a freshman just like Herbert. Really a really amazing player. Had 376 yards at USC in 86, when USC was still doing some things there. Really, really good quarterback and good NFL quarterback. I do also factor in NFL a little bit to some of this stuff. If they went, if they played long-term, if they had a good career. Number 8 is Kellen Clemens. Kellen Clemens is a rocket for an arm. The closest quarterback at Oregon that I've ever seen to Brett Favre. Just an amazing, amazing cannon for an arm. Over 8,000 total yards in his time, 02 to 05. Had 447 yards against the Washington Huskies. Just an amazing player. Went to the pros and actually had a very serviceable career. But just a cannon for an arm. Number 7, talk about favorites. And when I was in high school, this was the guy, Danny O'Neill. Danny O'Neill sat at a very unique spot in Oregon history. We want to give a lot of credit to some quarterbacks to kind of help make Oregon football, help that jump, make that leap. And Danny, definitely one of them. Very, very calm demeanor. Really, really nice guy. But, man, had an amazing Rose Bowl against one of the best defenses of all time, the Jerry Sandusky defense, which is not a great thing to bring up, but it is the truth. A really, really all-time great college football defense with Penn State. And Danny O'Neill went crazy in that game. He had 41 completions and went for 445 yards against them. We lost the game, but Danny O'Neill went crazy in that game. Number 6 is Bill Musgrave. I think Bill Musgrave is the guy that really started up this whole modern Oregon football run that we've been on a little bit. Bill Musgrave, really great player, gutsy player, played hurt, got sacked like crazy. And again, we're kind of going back now and comparing teams that were just not as good. For example, Chris Miller probably played on the worst teams of Oregon football of all of these quarterbacks that we're talking about. There is some real difficulty comparing a guy like Darren Thomas, who played on quite possibly the best offense of all time, and comparing it to Dan Fouts, a guy who played on an offense that was nowhere near in comparison to that, or Chris Miller, who played on just a terrible offensive team during those years, or even Bill Musgrave, where you're kind of climbing out of it. He had an absolutely crazy game at BYU, 489 yards, was the record for quite some time before Justin Herbert tied it. And he is an amazing, amazing player. Over 8,000 yards for his career. Bill Musgrave, absolute stud. We're in the top five. Top five for me, I got to put this guy up there. This guy's a year younger than me. We grew up in the same city. We played against each other in soccer and basketball, a variety of sports in CYO. A year younger than me is Joey Harrington. Joey Harrington is an absolute stud. He's the type of guy you want in the huddle. He's all that. He's got the it factor. Great player. Really gutsy player. Threw the ball a lot. The Mike Bellotti offense, very different. Opening the game up a little bit for that era of college sports. And Joey was just amazing. Six touchdown game against ASU. Back-to-back years. Okay, very rare you can ever do that, right? The only guy on the list with six touchdowns to do it twice and did it to the same team back-to-back, 01 and 2000. 27 touchdowns in 01. So Joey Harrington, really great player, kind of known as a comeback kid, but was an absolutely amazing, amazing player while he was there. And also, you know, just on a side note, it was very intelligent guy, very nice guy. I mean, the guy was, you know, I was at camps with them, everything else like that. And, you know, just one of the guys, but great, great player. Number four is Akili Smith. I think Akili Smith is on the top of the list for Oregon quarterbacks for what he did when he was there. Akili Smith is a really unique player. Late 90s, he was there. He goes to the NFL, obviously doesn't have the great success in the NFL with the Bengals, who the hell did. But Akili Smith, in my mind, really dynamic player. Baseball guy like Dennis Dixon, had the good wheels, but it was like baseball speed. You know, it was a different type of thing. It was always like he was ready to slide in, you know, and Akili Smith could really powerful arm, could really throw the ball, man. Oh my God. I've been watching so much film, and the Akili Smith film was so much fun to watch. Right when they got the Nike jerseys, right when they got this was the Nike era, right when that time when Nike took them over and they were having the kind of, it's actually a unique jersey. It's actually kind of built more like the Penn State jersey. There's no real flash other than the green and yellow color scheme. There's nothing really on them. It's very plain. But Akili Smith really did something to kind of help elevate Oregon to the national level and get them on that speed. 17.5 yards completion during the season, 32 touchdowns in 1998. Just an amazing year. The third on the list is the guy who we just saw go off, and what a great year and career he had. The local boy, Justin Herbert, really did some amazing things. Rebuilding the program, seeing the program in its darkest time, bringing the thing right back up, getting a Rose Bowl victory where he himself runs the ball in and becomes just a very unique person in the history of Oregon sports. Comes back for his senior year, looked at as one of the best NFL prospects in the country, and just showed up time and time again. Again, just like Joey Harrington, a very nice guy, very calm, humble demeanor, but just a stud athlete. I mean, just an absolute stud athlete. And this guy went crazy. 10,000 yards in the career. Only he and Marcus have that. Unbelievable career, man. 4 years with injuries. Doesn't finish some of those seasons. Or is losing games in some of those seasons. 489 yards against ASU in 2016 to tie Bill Musgrave, a record that I didn't see anybody breaking. In that game, he also ran for another 20-something yards. So he actually has the record for the most total yards, over 500 yards in that game, which is unreal. And then I think the biggest thing is just how he finished it with the Rose Bowl, working day and night throughout his whole career to put himself in that position where he could be the star of the show in the Rose Bowl with everybody watching. Number two, again, number one, everybody knows it, but number two to me is Dan Fouts. You know, I think a lot of people might disagree with it based on the fact that they take the old and they can't really compare with the new, but my dad and mom were there at Oregon, my aunt as well, when Fouts was there, and Fouts was a stud. Fouts had a really difficult team to work with at times, but Fouts was a stud. And as a freshman, he had his best year. He threw for 2,390 yards, which, again, compare that to some of these other guys' numbers, is not that much. But the game was different. He had some good players around him, don't get me wrong. But Dan Fouts came at a completely different time. But what he did for Oregon was he set a standard going to the NFL, going into being an NFL Hall of Famer, going to be one of the greatest Chargers of all time. At one point in time, he was voted that. I don't know if they've switched that up since then, but still the greatest QB, quarterback of the Chargers. I think he's better than Phillip Rivers. And changed the game of football completely. That Air Coryell, if you haven't seen it, if you're young and you haven't gone back and look at some of the NFL film stuff, which is also a great watch right now on quarantine, because that stuff never gets old. But go back and watch how the Chargers changed the game. They completely changed it. And Dan Fouts was a part of that at the forefront of the development of the modern game of football. So you got to give a lot of credit to Dan Fouts. And then number one, obviously, nobody can compete with Marcus. Marcus Mariota is so far above. He would be one of the greatest running backs in Oregon history if you just took his rushing yards. The guy is such a game changer. The guy is completely dynamic. He's got damn near every record you could want. But the craziest thing to me, the craziest number that I could find, he went 353 consecutive passes without an interception. That's 2012 into 2013. And he had 105 touchdowns in that year. I mean, crazy. In his career, I should say. But 353 consecutive passes without an interception. You know, Marcus did it all. Marcus obviously he's like the boy everybody wishes that their son could be like. You know, now that I have a son, he's going to be a freshman in high school next year. Marcus is the guy you want to emulate. Soft-spoken, loves his family, smart, driven, athletic, you know. He's got it all, man. And in the NFL, I really thought he had a chance to do something with Tennessee. And it felt like Tennessee was knocking at the door. And they just couldn't figure it out. I think their front office and everything else has just kind of crumbled a little bit. Then they switch it up this year, and they have a great year. And I personally, again, as a Duck, we all kind of think this, but I think that Marcus could have been in the middle of that as well. I didn't think Tannehill won them that many games as much as Derrick Henry, but he's going to get a chance. He's going to come over to the Raiders this year and possibly compete for that job. But even if Marcus never takes another NFL snap, he's still by far the greatest Duck quarterback of all time. He ran probably the best Oregon offense of all time. It's either him or Darren Thomas who ran the best Oregon offense and the best numbers. They won the most. They had the most success. But they also had some down times. There was also some times where there were some games they left on the table. Really difficult to lose some of those games. But, man, Marcus Mariota represented Oregon so well. And will be forever accepted as the greatest of all time at Oregon. All right, guys. That video, again, went way longer than I wanted it to. But I'm going to try to get these in. I'm going to try to give it some time. But here's what I would love for you guys. If you guys want to type up what you think your top 10 is, it'd be great. But I would also, during this quarantine time, I would love to have some chat. Set up a Google Hangout, set up a Zoom, do some sort of a connection where we can interact. Because I know there's a lot of people out there on who like sports chat, who would love to be able to kind of chat. I think that'd be a great thing to do during this time as well. All right, guys. Thank you guys very much for watching. Sport Chat 503. Adios.